Welcome back to Queen the Greatest Live. Previously, we have revealed how Queen approached creating their jaw-dropping set lists and the attention to detail needed to ensure the ultimate live experience for their fans. Now, with Brian and Roger, we explore the process of taking songs that were crafted in the studio and adapting them for the stage.
I think some songs are written with the idea of how it might sound live, like Sheer Heart Attack, for instance. That was, I always thought, oh, that would go, that would play, if we can play it that faster, that will go well live. But most songs I think we write or have been written as the song and the recording, and then some of them translate very much into, they want to be played live, you know, they're going to be effective live.
I think there's various processes. Sometimes you're in the middle of writing a song in the studio and you think, ooh, how would that be live? And that actually informs your recording process because you fashion it towards being a sort of live feeling kind of track, like something like I Want It All. It's pretty much designed to be a live track. In my head it always was, and you start thinking in the studio when you're playing it, you know, how would it be if I was on stage actually doing this? What would I be doing? What would people want to see? What would I feel I wanted to communicate? So you're almost in your mind building a live situation which you play off. Other songs not. Something like, well, The Miracle, Freddie's song, The Miracle, I don't think it was ever envisaged to be a live song, and it never was. It was purely a creation in the studio, something quite delicate and something which would be hard to reproduce on stage. I'm not saying it's impossible, I'm sure you could, but it wouldn't be directed towards a stage performance.
While the band knew instinctively that some songs would never be right for the live shows, there were others that they believed, with a slightly different approach, would result in a truly special moment with the fans, such as one particular track from A Night at the Opera.
We had this piano song which would have been very difficult to do live. It's got all these lovely, beautiful overdubs of harmonies and stuff. It's got a guitar solo and everything. How would you do that live? And I remember just sitting with Freddie and going, well, we could do it acoustic and you could just sing it. And it happened quite quickly. I mean, I just found ways of doing it, which are actually not very close to the record, but it compressed it all into something which we could perform quite easily, and we could invite the audience to sing with us, which they did. How I still love you. I still love
you. By the time Queen reached the 1980s, and with a decade of hit songs all ready to choose from, picking which ones to perform became harder. But it also provided an opportunity to get creative with how they revisited some of their old favourites.
Well, yes, I mean, we do have a lot. It's a big canon of songs. And it did get a bit harder. What do we leave out? What do we put in? And we just kept all our favourites in. I mean, we suddenly thought, oh, it'd be nice to hear that one again. And like some of the older fans would think, oh, blimey, that one. That's when I started listening to them, you know, Seven Seas of Rye and Keep Yourself Alive. Yeah, you know, very, very early stuff. We keep them pretty short normally. Yeah. To an altar, you are mine, I possess you.
As Brian and Roger have often mentioned, the connection they had with their audiences enabled the band and the fans to share in the journey as the songs evolved, often in ways they could never have imagined.
Oh, look out.
kind of hope that they will evolve live. I mean, We Will Rock You certainly was written with the absolutely clear intention that it would be an audience participation song. And it worked out, I'm happy to say, but it's different live. I mean, for a start, there's no drums on the original recorded version, but it's become a drum extravaganza, which is fine. And the audience do sing it. The stamping and clapping thing has evolved into a completely incomprehensible situation, because some people go bum bum psh, some people go bum bum psh, and you know, who knows, I don't even know anymore. But it doesn't matter, because the physicality is there and they sing, and obviously it's a staple. It's always going to be with us. We're same with Champions. So yeah, it's moments of discovery. Ooh, we could do this. I love waking up in the middle of the night and thinking, ooh, you know what, we could do this, you know, and you go in and you go, can we try this? And then you go, actually, yeah, that could pretty much work.